our top story, a big political move ahead of the upcoming general elections in India. The last of the Gandhi family members, one who was on the sidelines so far, has taken the political plunge. However, giving a limited role to her, the Congress party has brought in Priyanka Gandhi Vadra as the general secretary to lead its campaign in eastern Uttar Pradesh. Senior party leader Jyotiraditya Sindhya was named general secretary in charge of western Uttar Pradesh. The decision to give Priyanka Gandhi a formal post in the party comes days after the Samajwadi Party and the Bahujan Samajwadi Party kept the Congress out when they sealed a seat-sharing alliance for the bellwether state. The Congress reacted by announcing that it would contest all 80 seats in Uttar Pradesh. The move marks the first time Priyanka Gandhi will formally work for the party outside her family stronghold of Amethi and Raibareli in South Central Uttar Pradesh. While it once again brings focus back to dynastic politics, what has surprised many is the limited role that the star face of the party has been assigned. The Gandhis have always come in with a much bigger role in the Congress party. Now, Prime Minister Narendra Modi's Lok Sabha constituency of Varanasi falls in eastern Uttar Pradesh. The Congress has for years ceded enormous ground now to the SP and the BSP and later to the BJP in Uttar Pradesh. It has been out of office since 1989. The party could retain just two seats in Amethi and Raibareli in the state in the Lok Sabha polls. With no alliance partners, no organizational strength as of now, the party faces an uphill battle to turn the tide in the state, which sends the largest number of MPs to parliament. Observers say that bringing in Priyanka Gandhi may add momentum to the Congress campaign, but the move also exposes its limitations.
वजह है कि कांग्रेस पार्टी विचारधारा की लड़ाई लड़ रही है और कांग्रेस पार्टी बैकफुट पे कहीं नहीं खेलने वाली. कांग्रेस पार्टी फ्रंट फुट पे खेलेगी. कांग्रेस पार्टी अपनी विचारधारा के लिए लड़ रही है और चाहे प्रियंका हो चाहे ज्योतिरादित्य हो, कांग्रेस पार्टी के बहुत पावरफुल नेता हैं, लीडर्स हैं और इन दोनों युवा नेताओं से हम उत्तर प्रदेश की राजनीति को बदलना चाह रहे हैं. मेरी बहन जो बहुत केपेबल कर्मठ है कि वो मेरे साथ अब काम करेगी, तो मुझे पर्सनल भी बहुत खुशी हो रही है.
All right, Rahul Gandhi there batting for his sister, saying we will not be playing on the back foot anymore. And Karthikeya Sharma, our political editor, now joins us live for more on this. And Karthikeya, well, what does this really mean for Priyanka Gandhi personally and for the Congress in Uttar Pradesh and particularly in eastern Uttar Pradesh? And many also asking why just eastern Uttar Pradesh? Why not expand her role to the entire state?
See, there are a couple of things here. One, it is an acknowledgement of a political role which Priyanka Gandhi was playing from 1999. When Rahul Gandhi was studying abroad, Priyanka Gandhi was actually taking care of Raibareli and Amethi constituency. So it's not as if, you know, it's something very new for Priyanka. She's not a political novice. What is new for Priyanka is that the Gandhi family itself has acknowledged that Priyanka needs to be organizationally reinstated. It was the decision of the family that the Rahul will be the face. So you would remember, Bhairavi, after 2004, Priyanka got sidelined or confined to the family bastions. But now, with BJP becoming the pole party in Indian politics, one. Secondly, the Congress doing really badly. Something had to be done for the morale of the cadre in the most important state in terms of number, that is Uttar Pradesh. So the question which you asked me, why this truncated mandate? You know, BJP has divided Uttar Pradesh in number of segments. The earlier Congress too had appointed number of vice presidents and sector area presidents. So the reason for Priyanka to be given that part, which is the eastern part of UP, is that it has the VVIP constituency of Prime Minister. Yogi Adityanath comes from Gorakhpur. Senior leaders of BJP leadership, they are all from eastern Uttar Pradesh. That is why West has been given to another rising star in the Congress politics, but not being talked about today because, you know, today is Priyanka Gandhi's day, is Jyotiraditya Sindhya. It is because of him and the work he did in the Gwalior Chambal area that the Congress is in power, because it did so badly in other areas. So the saturated hits which he got is the reason why Kamal Nath is the chief minister. So that area has gone to Jyotiraditya. So the division is not only between Priyanka and some other person, it is between Priyanka and another rising star within the Congress, which is Jyotiraditya.
Right, and of course, very briefly then, Karthike, now, will she be contesting from her mother's seat? That's all, mother's seat. That is also, you know, in speculation as of now. And you are true when you say that she's not new to, you know, political campaigns. But many of these campaigns in Uttar Pradesh have really not paid off for Priyanka Gandhi and the Congress.
No, absolutely. You know, it's true for both the Gandhi. Sonia Gandhi came in 1998. She lost 1998 elections. She lost 99 elections. She lost vote of trust. And Congress was in 5 seats. By 2002, Congress was ruling in 16 states. So it happened. Look at Rahul Gandhi. He became an MP. 10 years, his party was in power. But then Rahul took the fall. 2014, he was completely demolished as a leader. You know, the whole word Pappu completely destroyed his image. He lost most of the assembly elections. And those which Congress won, Bhairavi, the credit went to Amrinder Singh or Narayan Swamy in Pondicherry. I think it is after these elections, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh and Rajasthan, that the senior leadership has realized that they will have to negotiate with Rahul. And that stability is there. So Priyanka Vadra, Gandhi Vadra, can also take that little jump. Because to my observation, the gradual vacation of space by Sonia Gandhi is a hint that probably she might shift to Rajya Sabha and might not fight the elections. So obviously, you have the empty seat of Rai Bareilly. But again, it depends whether Rahul shifts to Rai Bareilly and Priyanka fights Amethi, because Amethi is a tough seat today with Smriti Irani.
Well, all right, Karthike, lots of combinations and lots of speculation up in the air. Karthike, thanks very much indeed for joining us with all that. Well, let's move on to other news now. And flight operations at United States Newark International Airport were suspended temporarily following drone sightings. A pilot flying at a nearby Teterboro Airport informed the air traffic control that he spotted two drones flying nearby. The pilot said that one of the drones came within 30 feet of his aircraft. All flights at the New York Airport were grounded as a precautionary measure. New York International Airport is the 11th biggest airport of the U.S., hosting over 20 million passengers every year. Now, this incident comes just over a month after drone scare halted operations at London's Gatwick Airport for over 33 hours. Earlier this month, operations at London's Heathrow Airport, too, were held up for about an hour after drone sightings. Drones have become a major concern for aviation security. In December last year, British Security Minister Ben Wallace had warned that terrorist group Al-Qaeda was developing technology to bring down passenger jets. The minister cited a UK intelligence report that said that Al-Qaeda could use miniature bombs or drones packed with explosives to blow up planes. US authorities noted that there are nearly 1.3 million registered drones in the US and there are over 116,000 registered drones or drone operators. There are also hundreds of thousands of unregistered drones operating in the US skies as well. So danger looming large there for drone attacks. In other news now, what will be the biggest threats to your health this year in 2019? Is it dengue or Ebola? Well, here is the World Health Organization's list of the biggest global health threats of 2019. Air pollution and climate change topped the list. Imagine that. Polluted air has claimed 7 million lives every year and affects over a billion people. The Director General of the World Health Organization termed air pollution as the new tobacco. Air pollution has been linked to a whole host of health problems, including dementia, asthma, and heart diseases. Non-communicable diseases will pose the second biggest threat to your health, and that according to the World Health Organization again. And non-communicable diseases include cardiovascular diseases, cancer, diabetes, chronic respiratory diseases, mental health challenges, among others. Non-communicable diseases are responsible for 41 million or 71% of the deaths globally. Now, WHO also predicts an influenza pandemic would be the third biggest threat to global health this year. This year's prominent strain is H1N1 and the swine flu. Health crisis in vulnerable places also poses a major health risk. That's the fourth health risk. And over one-fifth of the world's population lives in crisis areas such as drought, famine, conflict or displacement. These 1.6 billion people have no access to basic health care. And the fifth biggest health threat this year stems from antibiotic resistance. Now, resistance to antibiotics is a result of overuse of antimicrobials in both people and animals. This can lead to inability to prevent infections, which in turn could compromise surgery or procedures such as chemotherapy. India is the worst abuser of antibiotics in the world. Well, if you plan to visit Bali in the near future, prepare to pay a tax. Indonesia's most sought-after holiday destination is mulling a tourist tax of $10. The Bali authorities are working on a bylaw which will make tourists accountable for environmental and cultural preservation. The revenue collected from the $10 tax will be used to fund programs for conservation. The levy is still under discussion. The authorities are deliberating on how the tax should be collected, whether it should be included in the airfare or if it should be collected at separate airport counters. But the policy is expected to be imposed only on foreign tourists. This plan, as Indonesia is fighting the growing volume of plastic waste on its beaches, Bali is particularly popular among Chinese and Australian holidaymakers. It welcomed up to 6 million visitors in 2018. An environmental agency recorded that the island produced 3,800 tons of waste every day. Out of this, only 60% ends up in landfills. This is not Bali's first step towards environmental conservation, however. Free plastic bags in supermarkets and grocery stores have also been banned in Bali since the beginning of the year. Other parts of Indonesia are also struggling with the problem of excessive plastic waste. The Pisang Batu River in the West Java area is one of the country's most polluted rivers. Hundreds of tons of rubbish collects there every monsoon, and residents, with the help of garbage trucks, have been trying to clean up the river, but the garbage never stops coming. But the latest from the Black Sea fire disaster, and all the sailors who were injured in the fire have now been transported to the Crimean city of Kerch for medical treatment. Authorities said that the condition of the sailors was satisfactory, and some of them were suffering from hypothermia due to their prolonged stay in cold water.
В настоящий момент состояние всех пострадавших удовлетворительно. У одного имеются небольшие ожоги в области шеи, клинически незначимые. У нескольких человек, более половины, вследствие переохлаждения, повышения температуры.
And 10 crew members were found dead and 14 others were rescued after two commercial vehicles caught fire in the Kerch Strait. The blaze broke out while fuel was being pumped in from one ship to another. The ships Candy and Maestro were from Tanzania and had a total of 31 crew members. There were 16 Turkish citizens and 15 Indians on board the two vessels. Both the ships were barred from using their usual port in southern Russia due to U.S. sanctions. The names of these ships were also included in a U.S. Treasury note published in November last year. Washington had advised countries from dealing with these vessels involved in transporting fuel to Syria. The note said that countries dealing with these ships could invite sanctions. Well, the 49th annual meeting of the World Economic Forum has kicked off in the Swiss Alpine town of Davos, and a wide range of topics are set to be discussed during its 400 scheduled sessions. On the first day of the four-day forum, the global economy, climate change, technological innovation and data management were among the most popular areas covered. WION Sumit Chaturvedi is in Davos speaking to the newsmakers and getting a sense of what's in store.
Do you think that we are able to maintain our growth? Because 6-7% growth, you know, we are among the top 5 economies in the world. How sustainable is that growth, and what are the policies which will be required to, you know, sustain that growth?
From my point of view, it is a must. It is mandatory for us as a country not only to maintain this level of growth for the size of the nation that we are, for what we need to do for the entire population for inclusiveness, we must grow at around 10% for the next many years.
And back home, sir, vote on account is going to happen. A lot of expectations. What is your assessment? Will it be a populist budget or will government, you know, will try to play safe? What is your assessment about the upcoming Feb 1 vote on account?
It's very difficult to say. You know, that we have seen in the recent elections in the states, we've seen populist measures, and well, politics needs to play their role also. And some of these populist measures are actually required for, let's say, look at the farm sector. Farm sector is not doing well at all. They do need some kind of support. How the government manages it, that's their call. They know best. But looking at the interim budget, I don't think we should see too much into the interim budget.
We are joined here by Mr. C.P. Gurnani, CEO and MD of Tech Mahindra, the top IT company of the country. So first of all, what's your first reaction to this time, WEF 2019?
You know, World Economic Forum, overall with the theme of globalization 4.0. And, you know, what is intriguing was, on one end, you saw all the stresses that the U.S. or China, other end, the Brexit, versus Europe, you know, some say the hope for the globalization is the Asian economy, the emerging markets economy. So I was actually quite impressed, and in a way that we're bringing the real issue of globalization on the table. And to me, the role of technology, the usage of, you know, or the need for connected world and connected solution was very, very prominent in the minds of people, and that is what has impressed me.
And well, Sumit has been tracking all the latest developments at Davos and sent us this report as well.
The day has just begun and discussions are happening across various platforms, and it's on different topics as well. But yes, they're talking about getting the world out of the slowdown, impending slowdown. Also, discussions are happening about how to make it overall equitable distribution of wealth. So a lot of discussions are happening. Day has just begun in Davos. It's quite cold here and it's just the beginning of the day. But yes, we are anticipating a lot of hot topics that will be discussed throughout the day in this Swiss resort town.
Well, the search for the missing plane carrying the Premier League player Emilio Sala has resumed after being temporarily called off yesterday. Police on the British island of Guernsey resumed the search for the plane carrying Emiliano Sala, who is presumed dead after debris was found in the water. Sala, who was flying from the French city of Nantes to Cardiff, was one of the two people on board the missing plane. The plane has been cruising, at 5,000 feet when the pilot requested to descend to a lower altitude on passing Guernsey, and it lost radar contact off just shortly later in the Channel Islands at 2,300 feet. Reports say that the Argentinian footballer sent a chilling WhatsApp audio message moments before his plane went missing. He could be heard saying that the plane was falling apart. The family of the missing footballer has reacted to the incident.
No sé qué pensar en este momento. Ya de las 6:15 que me avisaron por teléfono que había pasado eso, en ETN que pasaron, que me llamaron, los primeros son los que me llamaron. No sé más qué decir. No sé qué pensar, que las horas pasan y ya me da de pensar lo peor, no sé.
¿Cuándo tuvo contacto con él por última vez?
El domingo lo tuve a ver con él. Y bueno. Estaba muy contento, estaba que se iba a ir para allá de vuelta a un club más grande que...
Emil Sala joined the Welsh side just last week in a club record deal worth about $20 million and had gone to bid goodbye to his former teammates over the weekend. Now, Emiliano Sala scored 12 goals for Nantes in the season and was due to join training with his new employers, Cardiff City, which signed Sala for French club Nantes, also expressed shock, and his supporters staged a tearful vigil for the former player as well. Meanwhile, residents of his hometown in Argentina are in disbelief. They are hoping for a miracle as they want some good news.
incertidumbre y mucho dolor y mucha tristeza esperando la noticia buena de que se encuentren con vida.
Nosotros seguimos esperando un milagro, realmente otra cosa no se puede esperar.
Now, hectic preparations are underway for the 2020 Olympics in Japan, and visitors can expect to be ferried at airports in driverless buses. Yes, Japan has already started testing driverless buses to help navigate the Games rush at the airports. These are visuals from the Haneda Airport, where six Japanese firms, including the national carrier ANA, have started testing the prototype buses. And a safety driver is currently on board. You can see how his hand does not touch the wheel as the vehicle maneuvers maneuvers its way past a parked aircraft. The buses can hold up to 10 people at a time and can run at a speed of 30 kilometers per hour. They use GPS and magnetic strips on the road to mark their way.
Our aim is to be able to offer our users autonomous buses by the Tokyo 2020 Games, which is a pivotal date.